Tanya. Well, good morning and welcome to Massey University. I'm an employee of Massey University as well, except I work on the Palmerston North campus. So it's great to be up in Auckland and back at Albany. If you were confused by my accent, lots of people realise I'm from the South, but it's not the South Island. I'm actually originally from Mississippi. So I'm going to start by, I know it's Maori Language Month, but we're going to learn a bit of Southern. So are you ready? Good morning, y'all. Big mistake. You never say y'all to one person. Y'all is plural for you all. But you can say it to everybody in the room. So let's try one more time. Get real Southern. I'll try to get real Southern for you. Good morning, y'all. Very good. One of the key rules about speaking Southern is that you've got to make one syllable words at least two syllables, if not three or four. So y'all becomes y'all, and it just goes on and on. But having been in New Zealand now for over 15 years, my accent's become very, very unusual. And so you'll hear me every once in a while. You might think I'm British, probably not. You might think I'm Australian, probably not. But I really do feel that I'm a Kiwi, and it's a real delight and pleasure to be with you today. When I came to New Zealand 15 years ago, I contacted the Ministry of Education to find out what policies were available for gifted and talented education, because I was going to, as Sonia said, teach the teachers how to teach gifted. So I needed to know what the ministry thought about all that. And they said, well, actually, we don't have anyone that you can speak to about gifted students. And I thought, oh, well, do you have any publications about gifted students? No, we don't. And I hung up the phone and thought, hell, I've moved all the way across the globe to a country that has nothing for gifted and talented students. Maybe I should go home. But in the last 15 years, I've been in a very, very privileged position to have seen a lot of things happen for gifted and talented students. But this is the first time that I've ever talked to 230 gifted and talented secondary students in one room on a university campus. So this inaugural event, I hope, will be one of many, many more to come. And I hope that this will set the scene for students throughout New Zealand to come onto our tertiary campuses and find out what it means to be gifted and to be inspired and motivated to pursue your own passions. Now, the topic I'm going to talk to you about today is being gifted. And this is a very personal topic for me, but one that I don't normally share as a personal topic. I share it as an academic topic. But when Sonia and the committee asked me to speak to you, I thought, oh, I know what it's like actually to be a secondary student who someone has said is gifted. And I still question that label every day. So I'm going to share with you some of my history and some of my personal background, some of my how I identify and the journey I've been on in my life, some of what it means to me to be gifted and some of the experiences that I've had, hoping that it will resonate with some of your own experiences, and then for what it's worth, some of my advice for you as you pursue your passions and your goals and your journey through life. So I'll start off with a little bit of background. As I said, I came here from Mississippi 15 years ago, but my journey in life started, in the 1960s, shall we say, in the city of Memphis, Tennessee. How many of you have heard of Memphis, Tennessee? Aha! It was in the news recently because of the flooding of the Mississippi River. That's right. And one of the key distinctions you have to understand is there's a thing called the Mississippi, which refers to the river, and then there's a little state way down here in the south, this red one, called Mississippi. We're the poorest state in the Union. We have the lowest literacy rates, the highest teenage pregnancy rates. We do. So you can see why I question my giftedness. When you come from a state like Mississippi, you start to wonder. But there are a lot of great people who came from Mississippi. Elvis Presley, for example, was born in Mississippi. Oprah Winfrey was born in Mississippi. So was Morgan Freeman. Robert Johnson sold his soul to the devil at the crossroads in Mississippi, and that's where the blues come from. First Coca-Cola was bottled in Mississippi. Okay, they made it in Atlanta, but they bottled it in Mississippi. Who else have we got? B.B. King is from Mississippi, and he's going to be in Auckland sometime later this year. So my journey started in Memphis, and I was the first of five children. And my mother says that she told me from the time I was a very little girl that I could be anyone I wanted to be, and I could go anywhere I wanted to go, And she told the other four children that they could be anything they wanted to be and they could go anywhere they wanted to go within the United States of America. My mother also tells me that she and my father thought they were very, very good parents because I was such a good little baby girl. And I did everything right, and she changed my clothes just because she saw other mothers changing their baby's clothes. Until my brother came along 3 years later, and then she discovered that, yes, I was indeed a very good baby girl, and it wasn't down to their parenting that I was so good. So I went through life as the good girl, the oldest child, the one who always wanted to please everyone and wanted to excel and be the best, and I made straight A's, and I read lots of books. And when I was 6 years old, my mother took me to the public library, and I was reading chapter books, very American, Little House on the Prairie. And my mother wanted, the first of those books is Little House in the Big Woods. And my mother wanted me to read the second book. And the old librarian, you know, the sorts of mean librarians who don't let you talk in libraries, said, oh no, she's too young for that. You're going to hurt her. And my mother believed it. So I gave up reading chapter books at the age of 6, but I did go back to it. I can read chapter books now that I'm 44. I went through school, and as I said, I did really, really well at most things. And when I was in the 6th grade, which would be the equivalent of the end of primary school, my family moved to Greenville, Mississippi, from Greenwood, Mississippi. I made a lot of moves that I won't tell you about in between all that. And although I'd been top of the class all the way through and made really good grades, when I moved to Greenville, I found that the school that they enrolled me in, which was St. Joseph Catholic School, the home of the Fighting Irish. We are the Fighting Irish. The only way you get Catholics in a state like Mississippi is you bring them in from Ireland. There aren't many Mississippians who are Catholic. But what I discovered was that everything in 7th grade was what I had actually learned in 5th and 6th grade. And so I did the typical thing that you hear about with gifted kids. I found it all very boring. And that began a cycle of underachievement for me. And I think it was kind of a purposeful underachievement on my part because I had to find something to entertain myself with. And so I did. And it wasn't drugs or alcohol or boys or teenage sex or anything like that. It was leadership and being the editor of the school newspaper and just president of the student council and just engaging in everything else school had to offer except academics because the academics just weren't doing it for me. Unfortunately, I continued that throughout my high school career, and I was always what I call the bottom of the top. So, you know, you've got your top 10%, you've got your valedictorian in American schools, they've got the top marks, like your head boy, head girl. You've got your salutatorian, they're the next down. I was like number 10 of the top 10. But that was fine, it suited me. But one of the things that happened when I was in the 8th grade, going into the 9th grade, so right at the start of secondary school, was I was invited over summer into the counselor's office. And I was given a test, and I had all these puzzles I had to put together. That's the one that stands out in my mind the most. And I had to do a series of numbers backwards and forwards. And they would say a word, and I would give a response. Have any of you had this test? No, because they don't do it very often in New Zealand schools. It was an IQ test I discovered when I was in my 20s. And it was all very hush-hush as to why I had to take this test. And then I got to go to this special program. And it was called Project SAIL, S-A-I-L. And I've racked my brain to remember what SAIL stood for, but I think it stood for something like Searching the Atmosphere for Intellectual Learning. I don't know, something like that. And so I went to Project SAIL, and it meant that I didn't have to go to the boring classes. I could go to this other room. It's a really cool room. It had a couch. It had a computer. Now, this was in the 1980s, guys, so we called it a Trash 80. Some of your teachers may be familiar with Trash 80s, a TRS-80. It was a Radio Shack computer. It was huge, but we had a computer, unusual in the 1980s. We had a teacher named Mrs. T, and there were three girls who were identified for this program. So Allison and Denise and I would go to this huge classroom with the couch and the computer and the photo lab and the cameras, and we could leave history and French and biology and English and all those other classes. And I now, when I look back, realize I was in an enrichment program, and it was an enrichment program for gifted kids. But it made a huge difference to me in my schooling because, again, it got me out of what I considered to be rather boring, and it exposed me to new ideas. The first day of this enrichment program, we were given cameras and taken to the cemetery. A bit creepy. Cemeteries are a great place to learn about black and white photography. It's a very grey place. Amazing photographs from the cemetery. And from that, I ended up being the editor of the newspaper, and you know, it just all these other opportunities opened up. I recently was on Facebook. I can use Facebook even though I'm old. I was on Facebook, and I found my teacher, Mrs. T. Unfortunately, she didn't email me back quick or message me back quick enough. But it was a really neat time in my life. And then I went from there, even though, as I said, I was kind of the top of the bottom. Bottom of the top. I went through high school and did fairly well. Went to university. If you saw my grades from my first semester of university, well, it's a wonder I have a PhD because I failed everything because I had so much fun. There were so many other things to do at university besides go to Spanish at 8 o'clock on Friday morning. And but then I decided I better get my act together and decided to become a teacher. Trained in or studied elementary education, which is like primary education. Was one of the weird ones in that group because I didn't want to teach little children. I still don't want to teach little children. I wanted to teach more like, you know, intermediate age kids, and I wanted to teach science and maths. I did teach six-year-olds once. It was the worst experience of my life. It lasted a year. And I remember the boys in particular, they had this problem with urination, and they would go to the toilet and then they'd come and ask me to tie their shoes. It was just horrible. But anyway, so I gave up teaching at that point. So I went to school, went to university, and by the end of the university I was actually already bored with teaching. I thought, this is going to be a great life. I'm going to be in there with 30 kids who are going to pee on their shoelaces or learn their alphabet or whatever, and this isn't going to... There must be something more to it. So I started thinking about gifted and talented education. Went out and taught for my first year and knew I had to do something different. So I went to the University of Southern Mississippi, which is up there at the top, home of Brett Favre, who is an NFL football player. My son, who's 19, thought that you might know about football players from America, but I assured him you wouldn't. He's most famous to me for being in Something About Mary. Have you ever seen that movie? At the very end, when Brett walks in, that's Brett Favre from the University of Southern Mississippi, which is kind of ironic, but went there and took my first course on gifted education, and I fell in love, and I knew that was what I wanted to do for the rest of my life. It just resonated with me, and it made perfect sense that there were these gifted individuals out there who saw the world differently, who felt the world differently. And after that first course, the director of the program, Professor Francis A. Carnes, who ended up being one of my mentors, came to me and said, "You should enroll in a PhD." I thought, my God, I've only done one class and a master's degree. How am I going to get a PhD? And that's where the journey began. And she was actually one of the first people, although I'd been identified as gifted, Francis really pushed me and really believed in me and really said, "You can do it, Tracy. You will do it." I hated her sometimes. You know how you kind of hate your parents sometimes? Like, would you just back off and leave me alone? That's what I felt with Frances. But she pushed me and pushed me. So I finished my PhD. I thought I could do it with two young children, and I did. And when I was 29 years old, I moved to New Zealand and took up my position at Massey. It's one of the scariest experiences in the world to move to a foreign country because you don't even own any keys anymore. You just get on the plane and you don't have a key to a house or a car or a home or anything. So I came to Massey, and my work at Massey is, as Sonia said, I teach teachers how to teach gifted children. So that's kind of my journey and my experience. And through that time, there are a lot of different things I've thought about it, and I theorize about and conduct research about and try to convince teachers that gifted children have special needs. Gifted students don't see the world the same way as other students. Gifted students need opportunity to make choices, to study and pursue their passions. And one of the basis of those are the characteristics of gifted and talented students. Now, if I do this correctly, we can do this video. This is just a little video that I found that... I think you might enjoy. Just watch it and think about, is this really what it's like? Does it make sense to you? that loud enough? I might stop it there. It goes into another song for some reason. Now, how do I go back to where I was? I'm not very good at this stuff, actually, guys, so just excuse me for a minute. I will go to this one. There were a few things in there that I could relate to, and I heard you all giggle when the guy's smashing the pencil because he wants to be perfect. And I think that perfectionism is something that many of us strive for. But one of the things that when I teach teachers that I try to help them understand is that this label of giftedness, call it whatever you want. And there are groups in New Zealand that talk about bright buttons and tall puppies and small puppies. We've got all sorts of puppies growing in New Zealand. Well, we're trying to grow them or we're trying to cut the heads off of them. I'm not sure. We talk about talented children. We have Project Sail. We have Sage. We have, you know, all these little names that we give it. But what's really important is what we mean behind that label. Why are you here today? And as the video shows, you might be gifted in mathematics. Or it may be music, or it may be music and mathematics, or it may be creativity, or it may be language, or it may be sport. It could be a wide range of areas that you may have abilities in. You may have abilities in one particular area, very specific area. You may struggle with other areas. You may be the sort of kid I was where everyone's saying, oh, you're so gifted, you're so smart. Well, why was I barely scraping by in the bottom of the top? Why was I at 90%, not at 100%? What were the factors that were causing that, what I consider underachievement? What drove such high achievement as a young adult and as a young woman? What drove such determination in me at 29 to come over here and be pushing for promotions at 30 years old after a year? You know, where does all that come from? So there are different concepts of giftedness, there are different definitions of giftedness, and underneath that, there's a different gifted individual. So there's not a one-size-fits-all approach. So some of what I'll talk to you about, which are my experiences, may or may not resonate with you at all. They may not be your experiences. There's also, although there's all these positive characteristics of giftedness, like being the first one finished, there is also a flip side to that. It doesn't always work well in every context and with every individual. There's often a mismatch between the characteristics of giftedness and other people or other systems or even within yourself. When people say to me, oh, you are gifted, I have no idea what they mean by that. And I still can't work out exactly what areas I'm gifted in, but I sure as hell know I'm different. Because I feel that and I sense that all the time. One of the characteristics that we often see in gifted individuals is an ability to pick up things quicker, to learn things quicker. And from that, you often get bored. So I sit in meetings, and one of the strategies that I use now, you know, you sit in a meeting and people just go round and round and round and round and round the table. And you think, geez, didn't you get that 15 minutes ago? Can we move on, please? So one of my strategies is I count how many times a person uses a certain word. You can do this with your teachers. Try it. Your teachers will have certain words that they say often. Like, and so, and you just count how many times do they say and so in one maths class. It's quite entertaining, and you can do charts and analyses and things like that if you want to. So, I mean, I'm supposed to be helping you learn how to be gifted. You gotta survive somehow. You gotta entertain your brain somehow. So that's one thing you can do. Doodling, of course, is another highly productive activity. But one of the issues around the first one finished. And I can remember that in school, often being the first one finished, with the test. And the first thing they say when you go to turn it in is, did you check that? Well, yeah. Two or three times. I'm ready to go now. But the other thing about being the first one finished is you know, I sometimes feel like that I think that life is a race. And I got to be the first one to the finish line. And life actually isn't a race. And I don't really have to be the first one to the finish line. But I feel kind of like this guy who's gone to the guru, and he's saying, you know, what's the meaning of life? Make it quick, I've got an important meeting. If you saw my diary, if you saw my life, I filled up with things. I fill my calendar, I overfill my calendar. And then I do things like last night where I slept for 5 or 6 hours because I was so nervous about talking to you guys, or y'all, so nervous about talking to y'all, that I stayed up till midnight and then didn't sleep worrying about what I might say to you and this, that, and the other. And then I've got about 5 other things I was supposed to have been doing. So that trying to be the first to the finish line, always wanting to be ahead of everyone else. And it's that sometimes I think we have to make ourselves slow down and say, well, that's okay, I don't have to be the first one finished. And it's gut-wrenching when you aren't the first one finished because there's a competitive, or for me anyway, I'm quite competitive. So although I don't play sports, people think I play basketball because of my height, but I don't. I hate sport. I absolutely hate sports. Hate physical activity, really. Exercise and all that. Nah, can't be bothered with that. But sometimes you have to slow down. Did any of you ever feel that first one finished? Are you the first ones finished sometimes? Yeah. Yeah, it's kind of... I think the theory that I most kind of resonate to is this notion of being the overexcited. There's a theory by Dabrowski, the theory of overexcitabilities, and I won't bore you with all the details of the theory, but basically he and others believe that gifted and talented people experience the world in a different way and sometimes are overexcited in these 5 different areas: psychomotor, sensual, intellectual, imaginational, and emotional. And the first time I read about his theory was actually, I'd finished my PhD by then, so you never stop learning, that's for sure. Even though they tell me it was a terminal degree, which I found quite depressing. It sounded like an illness. And I read about this theory and thought, oh my gosh, this is making sense. So with the psychomotor, a need to move, although, as I said, I don't really engage much in physical activity, this inability to sleep sometimes. Sometimes I can feel my foot tapping, you know, like, can we just go on to the next page, please, and do the next thing, please? I get quite, I mean, I'm not nervous today for some reason, but sometimes I, you know, I kind of feel that shakiness. The sensual, and that's not sensual as in sexual, but really experiencing the world and feeling the you know, looking at a piece of artwork and it just brings you to tears. Last year I went to Paris for the first time and I stepped out of the train and saw the Louvre in front of me, and I just, you know, and I stood there in front of the Mona Lisa and, oh my God, I just can't believe that I'm there and it's there in front of me, and it's just that whole sensual overexcitability. Learning never stops. You know, seeking the answers to questions, questioning the answers to questions, making the connections between things, abstract connections quite often is often a characteristic of gifted students, and being on creative overdrive, the imagination just goes and goes and goes. But the one that really, for myself personally, the emotional overexcitabilities is something I've really struggled with, and it's that sense of sometimes the cup runneth over. I'm just so grateful and so thankful and so just about the people in my life and the opportunities that I've had. But sometimes I have the opposite of that, where I worry so much. And I don't worry so much about myself. You know, a friend's getting a divorce and I'm not sleeping at night trying to solve her problem for her, or worrying about her. What's this going to mean for her? Or my kids. I have 4 kids myself, none of whom I'd consider gifted. Because they're teenagers. Sorry, guys, but they're older than you. They're older teenagers. They're actually young adults. They're 19 to 21 years old. And I will say that we're a blended family, so 2 are my stepchildren. I didn't have 2 sets of twins or anything like that. But, yeah, you know, I worry about the kids, and I just... And this is where my passion for you comes through, that I just think, oh, these kids, you know, we want to do something for them. And so sometimes I feel a little bit like Alice in Wonderland there, who says, I know who I was when I got up this morning, but I think I must have been changed several times since then, because in the course of a day, all these overexcitabilities can come in and create a bit of havoc within ourselves. I always knew I was the different kid. In my family, I said I was the oldest of 5, and actually I'm the only brunette, and I'm the only person with curly hair like this. This is not a perm. I would never pay money to have my hair look like this. Ever. I was the only brunette out of 4 were blondes, and I was the only one who was, you know, loved to read and didn't want to play sports, hated sports and all that sort of stuff. So, in my family, I felt like I was the different kid. I can remember coming home from high school and my mother, I was so excited because we had dissected a fetal pig in biology. They probably don't let you do things like that anymore, but anyway, we used to get to dissect, you know, animals. And I was so excited, and I actually had the pig's tail in my purse. I think my friend Denise, who was in the gifted program, had another body part, but I can't, you know, guarantee that. And I was really, really excited about this, and I went in the kitchen to my mother, who was cooking dinner, and I said, oh, you know, we dissected this pig, and it was so cool, Mom, and we did this, or Mama, it was so cool, Mama, because we did this. And she said, just get out of my kitchen with that science book. I don't know where you come from. And she didn't mean it as negative as that sounds, but what she meant was, where do you come from? Why are you so different? So I had a theory at about the age of 17 or 18, when I think that's when a lot of us start to question where we come from. Like, where did I come from? I have an aunt who everyone always said I looked a lot like, and she suffers from bipolar disorder. And so she was always a little bit different. So I came up with this theory that actually she was 18 when I was born. So actually I was her baby, and my mother and father had adopted me, so that she wouldn't have the shame and sin and, you know, of having had a baby. But anyway, they swear that I am their child. But I just always felt very different, not only in my family, but also different in the way I see the world and in the way that I do things. I was at a meeting the other day, and it was driving me crazy because they had this... The people were obviously very logical thinkers, which was one of the characteristics that you saw. And they had all these lines going across, and you were supposed to fill out this chart, and we were supposed to go in these blocks. And I was just getting more and more anxious about these lines going one direction, 2 directions. And I wanted bubbles. And I wanted, like, you know, errors going on. And so I just erased the whiteboard. And you can do that when you become the guru, because they are like, oh, Tracy wants to erase the whiteboard. Okay, yep, we'll do it a different way, because that's what Tracy wants to do. But, you know, I just think, why can't you guys think like me? Why can't you think out that way? Why are we thinking like this? Anyway, these are some other different kids in this video that you might enjoy seeing a little bit about, if it'll go back to the start, though.
Here's to the crazy ones. The misfits. The rebels. The troublemakers. The round pegs and the square holes. The ones who see things differently. They're not fond of rules, and they have no respect for the status quo. You can quote them, disagree with them, glorify or vilify them. About the only thing you can't do is ignore them. And while some may see them as the crazy ones, we see genius. Because the people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do.
Jim Henson, by the way, is from Leland, Mississippi, 15 minutes down the road. He's the guy who created Kermit the Frog. Just in case you didn't know that. I think one of the other, the know-it-all I've put up here. I don't think I know everything, but I don't have a lot of patience. Sometimes that came up in one of the videos. I find myself sometimes saying, I'll just do it myself, thank you very much. I don't like working in groups. I don't like working on committees, unless they're committees of like-minded people. And if I can select the committee, then I'm even happier working on the committee. I would never be rude enough to say to someone, oh, you're wrong. But, well, not the way that this little girl in the pink does it. But I sometimes get quite frustrated because I think, don't you just get it? Or why can't you do it my way? And I think that's something that a lot of gifted kids, you know, we end up in group situations or trying to work with other people, sometimes mixed ability, sometimes people who don't get it, who don't have the same drive, the same passion, they let you down because they don't do what you think they should do in the time that you want to do it. And I just liked that quote by Albert Einstein. So I threw it in there. Probably one of the biggest issues is the imposter syndrome. And Sonia mentioned that before, feeling like a fraud. Mike Myers talks about, I still believe any time the no-talent police will come and arrest me. You know, it's like, I'm going to get caught out. Eventually, they're going to work it out, that I really don't know what I'm doing up here. I liked the next quote too, you know, I didn't think I deserved the acclaim. You know, that kind of underselling. That's probably not a bad thing to feel like you're an imposter because it keeps you on your toes, because you want to make sure that you're perfect and you do things really well. Nicole Kidman saying that, you know, she always thinks the producers are going to look at me and fire me. And that she calls up and quits the movie the week before. It's better to quit than to be fired, I guess. So the imposter syndrome, did any of you ever suffer the imposter syndrome? Feel like a fraud? Yeah, I see some people going, yeah. The perfect procrastinator. Perfectionism is a great thing. Perfectionism's awesome because it can be a really good enabler. It can, you know, you can actually get the top marks and you can get things just perfect. It can be a great excuse for never finishing anything or not even starting. So you can procrastinate and say, oh, well, you know, just didn't get there because I'm just still trying to think it through. This is my thing. I'm always trying to think it through. Always, I've just got to think it. Before I actually write it on paper and commit it to paper or put it on the computer screen, I better think about it some more. I loved the cartoon there about Procrastinators Anonymous. Tonight's meeting's postponed to be rescheduled eventually. I think perfectionism can actually be a really good thing because it can ensure excellence and you know, you can get top marks or you can get the recognition you need, but it can also be quite a paralyzing experience. It can prevent you from submitting the assignment or finishing the work or even getting started on the work because you want it to be perfect. It also sets the scene, the expectations of others. You know, if I submit the perfect journal article one time, then every time I submit something, it's going to have to be perfect, isn't it? That's what logic tells you. So, perfectionism, and I did notice that a lot of you laughed about that. I don't know if you can read at the bottom, this time for bed, Calvin says, I think. That's what I said, but I haven't finished my paper for school yet. I need more time. How much more time do you need? I just have to write it. I'm kind of doing that on a few projects I keep carrying around the country. I have flash drives. I have about 5 flash drives. I have no idea what's on them. But I just carry them around from hotel room to hotel room, bag, you know, airport lounge to airport lounge. Haven't started them yet, but I will eventually. And you can get a bit anal retentive too, you know. Like, you just have to let it go sometimes and say, well, that's the best I can do. The great expectations. This was something I really... whether they were real or just perceived expectations, but the expectations that I feel other people have of me, whether it's my husband or my children or my parents or my students or my boss or my friends, expecting me to always do it well and always do it perfect. So I sometimes have real meltdowns. I just lose it. My husband is the main person who cops the meltdowns. So he must be a good man. He's a psychologist, so that helps. That's what you should do. Marry a psychologist. There you go. But it's not just the expectations that I think other people have of me. It's my own expectations of others and my own expectations of myself. So I can feel quite gutted when things don't go the way I think they should, and I can beat myself up about it. I think with expectations, you sometimes have a lot of guilt that you experience. And having those expectations can lead to disappointment, but then again, you know, how do you balance it out? Where do you set the bar? So some of the lessons that I've learned throughout my life, this is me trying to give advice. My children won't listen, so I've got 230 other teenagers who might listen to me. This is pretty cool. Push the boundaries, but exceed the expectations. Don't ever let anyone tell you you can't do something. You know, there's an issue around ageism that creeps in sometimes, and sexism and culturism and all sorts of isms that make you think, I can't do that. But you can, actually. And I've done it all the way through, particularly in my adult life. You know, they say you can't come to a university and apply for a promotion in the first 2 years. Well, bullshit. Don't record that. You can, and you can get it. You just have to push. So exceed what other people expect of you. I think finding a mentor is really important. And a mentor may be an older student. It may be somebody you work with. It may be a teacher. For me, my mentor was Frances Carnes when I was working on my doctoral studies. And I still, you know, get emails from her regularly. And I kind of want to go, I finished my PhD, Dr. Carnes. I did it. I'm done. But she pushed me and pushed me. I'll tell you a quick story about Dr. Carnes. When you finish your doctoral degree, you have an oral examination or an oral defense. And in the United States, you have a committee of about 8 professors who sit around in a table in a room with no windows, and they ask you questions about your study. And you have to defend your study. And it's a very nerve-wracking experience. It goes on for a couple of hours. Well, then after you defend your study, and they do something very similar in New Zealand, we do the same sort of thing, you're asked to leave the room, and they make a decision as to whether you should be granted a Doctor of Philosophy or whether you should go do more work or whether you should just bugger off because you just wasted the last 5 years of your life and maybe you should do something altogether different. So I left the room, and eventually the other professors came out and they said, congratulations, Dr. Riley, congratulations, Dr. Riley. And I was thinking, oh, I must have done it. They call me Dr. Riley. They're not calling me Tracy. Woo. And I walked in to see Dr. Carnes. And in American universities, you call your professors doctor. You don't call them first names. None of that sort of stuff happens. So I walked in, and Dr. Carnes said, well, Dr. Riley, you can call me Francis. And I said, well, Dr. Carnes, you can call me Tracy. It just didn't make any sense to me that suddenly I was this important person. But Frances was a real mentor to me because she not only understood my passion about gifted and talented education, she gave me opportunities. I could go to her on a personal basis. You know, I was pregnant with my first child when I was studying with her, and she was at the hospital the next morning. You know, we developed a friendship. It was more than just somebody who knew more than me working with me to teach me. We were learning together and working together. But also having the opportunity to be a mentor is quite rewarding, because there's something about having abilities and gifts that I think means we need to share that with other people. We need to give back what we have. And the opportunity to be a mentor, one of the greatest things for me in my position at Massey is working with teachers and then coming to conferences like this and looking around the room and saying, oh, I taught that person. Oh, I taught that teacher. I worked with that teacher. Or a professional development with that teacher. So the opportunity to mentor is really important. It's also important to learn to say no, and I feel like I'm really being a hypocrite here because I don't say no often enough. But you'll find that you'll have lots of opportunities that come your way. And sometimes you just have to say no because you need to be able to seek that balance in your life. It was really hard to say no, though, if it's something you're enthusiastic about. And that's where I get myself into trouble. Everything sounds like a good deal to me. So, oh, yep, I can do that. Oh, yep. One time I scheduled myself for 3 different events in the country, in 3 different cities. So just be really careful. I was supposed to be in Palmerston, North Wellington, and New Plymouth all at the same time on the same day. Because I just say yes, and I don't always have my diary with me. Accept your abilities. Accept what you can do. Just face it, that's who I am, that's what I'm capable of, but also know your limits. Know what you can't do, know where you need support, where you need help. Don't expect yourself to be able to do everything. Surround yourself with like-minded peers. I'd really encourage you, I see you're all sitting because I can see your color, you know, a very color-coordinated room. Break away from that. By the next session, I want to see some reds with some greens, with some blues, with some maroons. You know, don't be afraid to mix and mingle with other people in this room. Not just the kids from your college, from your school. You'll make connections with people who are similar to you that may last you the rest of your life. One of my best friends in the world, who I only see once every maybe 5 or 10 years, but we are on Facebook together, was in the gifted program with me in high school. And we just click, we can just pick up where we left off. Believe in something. Find something you believe in, and I'm not meaning this in a religious sort of sense, although that's absolutely perfectly fine, but find something you really believe in, you know, and pursue that. I believe in you. That's why I pursue what I do. I believe in gifted and talented students. I believe they do exist. I'm not a naysayer. I believe they're out there, and I believe that we have an obligation to them and a responsibility to them. That's my belief, and I pursue that belief in everything I do. Follow your dream, whatever your dream is. And you'll probably have multiple dreams. And actually, you'll have things that weren't dreams. I never dreamed of coming to New Zealand. I mean, please don't think I sat at home in Mississippi when I was 6 and thought, when I grow up, I'm going to New Zealand. Because I didn't. And I don't mean that as a criticism of New Zealand, but it never crossed my mind that I'd end up in New Zealand. And I go places and I literally pinch myself and think, how did I end up here? I'm just a little girl from Mississippi. So follow your dream, but also don't be afraid to pursue other dreams, those unexpected dreams. Some of them are even nightmares, but, you know, my first marriage was a nightmare, but anyway. Then I married the psychologist. Everything's been good ever since. Give something back. Share your gifts. You know, don't keep it all to yourself. Give back to your community. Give back to your family. Give back to your whānau. Give back to New Zealand. Don't be part of the brain drain. Stay here in New Zealand. We need you in New Zealand. Don't go to Australia. It's not that cool. I've been there. No, seriously, share your gifts. Don't keep it all to yourself. Within Maori culture, and I think this is something that we can all learn from, you know, you're not considered gifted unless you're actually sharing that with other people. You may be the best doctor in the world, or the best opera singer in the world, or the best artist in the world. But if you're not actually sharing your abilities for the betterment of the community, then you're actually not all that gifted. Think differently. You know, like the video showed. Think outside the square. Take the risk. You can make a difference. It might just be a small difference. And sometimes you might think, there's nothing I can do. I'm just this little kid sitting in Auckland, New Zealand. You are in the biggest city in New Zealand, so you can make a little bit of a difference. You've got more people you can impact. But you can make a difference. Learn to laugh at and with yourself. I mean, you might have multiple personalities, so you might need to laugh with those different personalities. I don't think I have those. But no, it is important that you can learn to laugh. Like, oh, well, what the heck? I was going to say another, but I didn't. WTF, as my kids say. Don't be afraid of hard work. It's not easy. You have to work hard. Don't be afraid to work hard. Put the hours in. Right now, school might seem cruisy. In primary school, it might have seemed cruisy. Go out there and seek the challenge and work your little butts off. Because hard work does pay off. If you're not working hard, then I don't think you're doing the right thing. None of it's just going to come to you. Know what your strengths are and feed your passions. You know, if you're passionate about art, then pursue art. You know, if you love reading, sit down and read. If you love designing computer websites, then design computer websites. You know, don't feel like you've got to conform to other people's passions or other people's expectations. Feed your own passions so that you can make a difference to the world. There was a, why is this doing this? Don't do this. Woo! That's for the gifted ones. Did you get it? No. Back in 1999, although I've heard it's in 1996, there was an American gentleman who gave a keynote address to a group of university students. So, and I realize that you're not at university yet, but given you're gifted, you probably could be at university. And I just have always liked this. And he starts off by saying, wear sunscreen. And he says, of all the things I'm going to tell you, the only thing that's scientifically proven is that it's good for you to wear sunscreen. So of all the things I've told you this morning, really, it's just what I think. I don't know that there's any scientific evidence behind this, particularly the advice I've given. But I'm going to leave you with this wear sunscreen, and then we'll have some time if anybody has any questions or we want to discuss anything any further. So let's hope this works.
Ladies and gentlemen of the class of 99, wear
can you hear that?
If I could offer you only one tip for the future, sunscreen would be it. The long-term benefits of sunscreen have been proved by scientists, whereas the rest of my advice no basis more reliable than my own meandering experience. I will dispense this advice now. Enjoy the power and beauty of your youth. Never mind. You will not understand the power and beauty of your youth until they fade. But trust me, in 20 years, you'll look back at photos of yourself and recall in a way you can't grasp now how much possibility lay before you and how fabulous you really were. You are not as fat as you imagine. Don't worry about the future, or worry, but know that worrying is as effective as trying to solve an algebra equation by chewing bubblegum. The real troubles in your life are apt to be things that never cross your worried mind, kind of blindside you at 4 p.m. on do one thing every day that scares you. Sing. Don't be reckless with other people's hearts. Don't put up with people who are reckless with yours. Floss. Don't waste your time on jealousy. Sometimes you're ahead. Sometimes you're behind. The race is long. In the end, so be it yourself. Remember compliments. Forget the insults. If you succeed in doing this, tell me how. Keep your old lovers. Throw away your old magazines. Stretch. Don't feel guilty if you don't know what you want to do with your life. The most interesting people I know didn't know at 22 what they wanted to do with their lives. Some of the most interesting 40-year-olds I know still don't. You have plenty of calcium. Maybe you'll marry, maybe you won't. Maybe you'll have children, maybe you won't. Maybe you'll divorce at 40. Maybe you'll dance the funky chicken on your 75th wedding anniversary. Whatever you do, don't congratulate yourself too much, or berate yourself either. Your choice is your half chance. So are everybody else's. Enjoy your body. Use it every way you can. Don't be afraid of it or of what other people think of it. It's the greatest instrument you'll ever own. Dance. Even if you have nowhere to do it but in your own living room. Read the directions. And if you don't follow them, do not read beauty magazines. They will only make you feel ugly.
Right, my last bit of advice to you, it's not really advice, I guess, but I just want to thank you for being who you are. I want to thank you for the promise that you hold for New Zealand. I want to thank you because I know in this room somewhere is the doctor who's going to look after me when I'm old and decrepit, and the teacher who's going to teach my grandchildren, and the banker who's going to take care of my husband's money, because I don't have any, but maybe he will, I don't know. No, seriously, I want to thank you for being who you are. You believe in yourself. If you walk away from this knowing nothing else, believe in yourself, because you've got a great future in front of you. Are there any questions or comments? So we've got just a couple of more minutes, I think. Don't be shy. I've put my email. Oh, yes?
What was your IQ?
Well, you know what? I don't know. That's a good question. Do you think it was lower than the average?
I don't know.
You don't want to answer that? I honestly don't know what it was. The bell curve would say that it would have to have been over 120 or 130 to have been in the gifted program. But given we were in Mississippi, they could have set it a bit lower. Any other questions? Right, well, thank you very much. Have a fantastic day. Enjoy your time here at Massey. And I hope I'll see you on campus sometime.